Tonight's presentation is, I have to tell you, I'm so fascinated by Ibn Ezra. He is completely amazing. I have given three lectures now on Ibn Ezra, and every time I do the research for a presentation on him, I say, oh my gosh, I'm missing so much, I got to go back and do more. And in fact, every time I go back and do more, I learn so much about this individual. He really is a phenomenal player in the intellectual history of the Jewish people, and that is quite a complicated scene. So I'm hoping that you'll enjoy it as much as I. But in response to some of the people on the internet who asked for a joke, I will tell you a joke now. It's possible that I may cut it out of the internet version. You can check later. I'll judge by how well you laugh. This is, I think, one of those quintessentially Jewish jokes that captures a certain element of the unique Jewish Weltanschauung that can't adequately be translated into other cultures. And when you get to the punchline, you'll see what I mean. So the joke goes like this. It's a little bit of a, it's got some black humor to it. So there's this older woman with her grandchild, and they're visiting Miami Beach. And they're walking along the seashore, and it's beautiful, and the sun is shining, and the waves are rolling in. And then there's somehow a heaviness in the air and a silence, and the birds fly away. And then all of a sudden, the woman looks out, and she sees that the water is rushing away from the shoreline. So she's never seen that before. And her young grandchild, goes running far into where the riptide was, as it were, and standing quite far out. And then all of a sudden, of course, I'm sure you figured it out, Dr. Levine, it's a tsunami, and the water comes rushing back and envelops the child, and God forbid, takes him out to sea. And the grandmother is left there completely bereft and broken. And she falls to her knees and she raises her hands to heaven. She says, Ribono Shel Olam, you know what I've gone through in my life. You know what I have sacrificed. You know how I've always kept your Torah and your values central to my way of life. And now this, where you sweep away my grandchild into the ocean. No, it cannot be. I protest. Bring this child back to me, because you know I have been a loyal servant all my life. And there's a rumbling in the clouds, and there's like lightning far off, and all of a sudden the sea comes rushing back, and the child flies out of the waves and is deposited straight at her feet. And she picks him up, and she looks him all over, and he's okay, and he's fine. And then she looks up to the stars, and she says, he had a hat. All right, there's something Jewish about that joke. Yeah, I don't know if I should tell this joke. But anyways, okay, now a lot of people also complain on the internet, how come it takes you so long to get to the material? So the material tonight is about Abraham ibn Ezra, one of the most famous of the Andalusian poets, and a great commentary on the Bible, and also a phenomenal scientist, as we shall see. Tonight, the new stuff that I haven't done in previous classes is going to be primarily on his astrology, which is absolutely fascinating. I was really spellbound by it. Let's just do a little bit more of the delay stuff, the good and welfare that we have to explain what's going on. First of all, thank you to our sponsor. This is Chel Boded, Arkansas. You'll recall he's sponsored classes in the past. He's actually a major in the U.S. Army, and he prefers to remain anonymous. He's a big fan of these lectures. He uses the term Chel Boded, meaning like a Chayal Boded, a lone soldier, because in honor, I'm proud to say, of my son, who is a lone soldier in Israel. And he wishes us the best, Shana Tova, for more online programs. Also important, good and welfare. Next week in this room, we have the book launch of my new book, which I'm really very proud of. It is a historical analysis of the Holocaust writings of Rabbi Kolonimus Kalman Shapiro, the Eish Kodesh, also known as the Piasechna Rebbe. This is an absolutely amazing story of spiritual courage in the Holocaust, and I look forward very much to sharing it with you in this room. We will have some food, and we'll have some music, and we'll have an opportunity to speak about his tremendous heroism. And by the way, this week,
around the world, it's amazing the surge of interest in this 20th century master. I went to an event on Saturday night. There's an event tomorrow night in Williamsburg. There's a major event in Heichal Shlomo on Yerushalayim on Wednesday night. And of course, our event here next Monday night. These are all surrounding the Yahrzeit, or the death anniversary of the Rebbe, which, based on German records of the massacres in the camp known as Travniki, and a few witnesses who claim to have seen him killed, he was either killed on tomorrow, or tonight really, in Dalet Cheshvan or Hei Cheshvan, but we don't know for absolutely sure which day he was killed, but it was at this time. It's his 74th year since his murder, and it's a great honor to be able to speak about him Monday night. Also kind of cool, we won't talk about it too much tonight, but the Sephardic lectures have actually been getting a tremendous amount of attention. I'm really pleased, and I've been asked to lead a tour to Spain and Portugal this summer. So we're going to go, see, here's my name. I put a big arrow with the word yay over here. It's on the Douro River. We're going to sail from Lisbon into mainland Spain and take a lot of stops along the way. And it's going to be a really fantastic deluxe trip. I certainly, I'll send you more stuff on the internet about what it is, but I think it'll be a really amazing opportunity to learn about this history in situ as opposed to here in the holy city of Brooklyn. Okay. Let's go to one more detail about tonight's lecture. A thank you to Dr. Shlomo Sella, who is my major source for today, my major new source beyond what I've used in previous lectures. He wrote some amazing monographic studies of Ibn Ezra's science, which is way above my head. Even though it's like 800 years old, it's still science that's hard for me to understand, but it is fascinating, especially the unique nexus of the Hebraic content of his science and the history of Jews in the transmission of Greek and Arabic culture into the Western European world. So most of the new material in this class really comes from his amazing work. I highly recommend his studies. They are absolutely fascinating. Okay, so let's begin with what we know about Abraham ibn Ezra. He is a very close contemporary of Yehuda HaLevi, who we spoke about last week, and in fact, they were related by marriage. Beautiful Hebrew term, I'm sure most of you are familiar with this term, mechutan or mechutan, which means the one with which I am related through marriage. From chatuna is marriage in Hebrew, chasan is groom, and we don't have this word in English, you know, like people, like the parents of my sons-in-law are my mechutanim. I have a relationship with them, even though there's no blood relationship. So he was mechutan to Yehuda HaLevi. Ibn Ezra's son married Yehuda HaLevi's daughter. We saw last week how poorly that ended when Yitzchak ben Abraham ibn Ezra decided to leave his wife and stay in Egypt rather than go back to Spain. It ended even worse, as we shall see shortly. He eventually ended up converting to Islam, which was, to use the Arabic word, ashanda, at the time, but we'll speak about that in due time. But Abraham, the father, was, like Yehuda HaLevi, came from the Christian north, most likely from Tudela, the same town as Yehuda HaLevi, and then he made his way to southern Spain, to Cordova, and possibly Granada as well. He was then driven out of the region in the 1140s, with the Almohad invasion. You'll recall we spoke about these two groups of Berber Muslims who come up from the south, and they impose an altogether more rigid Orthodox interpretation of Islam upon the much more cosmopolitan and tolerant Andalusian Muslim culture. When I say Orthodox in this sense, I mean not in the like Jewish Orthodox, which in Brooklyn is of course synonymous with very good, superlative, excellent, things like that. In this sense, I mean Orthodox in the sense of orthos doxos, one way. One way, meaning my way, or the highway. So they were very, very strict. They did not agree with the Andalusian tolerance of drinking alcohol, which is itself forbidden to Muslims, but also drinking alcohol with Christians and with Jews, with the tolerance of Jews in high positions of authority, like we looked at Shmuel HaNagid and other figures like that. And so there was a period of intense persecution where the Jews who had enjoyed up until this point, until the 1140s, a relatively secure existence, they were driven out of southern Spain. A large number went to the Christian north, over the Pyrenees into what would be France. Others, like the Maimon family, with their son Moses, made their way across North Africa, then to Egypt. And in the case of Ibn Ezra, he made his way to Italy, and then to France, and then ultimately to England, where he most likely passed away. Ironically, although he was a very gifted poet, and I would like to read you some of his poetry momentarily, and that's kind of like the way in which so many of these Andalusian Jews made their fame, he really came into his own in his 50s when he was in exile, when he was forced to stop communicating in an Arabic cultural environment and had to translate much of his knowledge into a Jewish environment in Europe where they did not have access to Arabic learning. And he had to begin to express himself much more extensively in Hebrew, which turned out to be, ironically, the very linguistic fact that saved much of his knowledge. So let's get a sense of his poetic sense, of his poetic sensibility, because that's where he started from intellectually. And you'll also get a feel for his unique personality, quite acerbic. Actually, it's ironic I should tell you that joke about the tsunami, because it really is an Ibn Ezra-esque kind of joke. That's a great word, Ibn Ezra-esque. I just have to say it faster so it sounds like I didn't plan and make it up. Ibn Ezra-esque. Ibn Ezra-esque. All right, okay, here we go. Here is a poem that is really exemplary of his poetry of exile, describing his feelings after having been exiled from Spain. Lament for Andalusian Jewry. This is, by the way, the brilliant translations of Peter Cole. Calamity came upon Spain from the skies, and my eyes pour forth their streams of tears. I moan like an owl for the town of Lucena, where exile dwelled, guiltless and strong, for 1,070 years unchained. Unchanged, of course, the Andalusian Jews believed that they had originally come with the exiles from Jerusalem. So 1,070 years means, you know, since the exile from the destruction of the temple in the first century. Until the day that she was expelled, leaving her like a widow, forlorn, deprived of the scriptures and the books of the law, and as the house of prayer took folly in. Some men murdered and others sought shelter. For this I weep and mourning a wail, if only my head were a fountain of water. I shave my head and bitterly keen for Seville's martyrs and sons who were taken, as daughters were forced into strangeness of faith. Cordoba's ruined like the desolate sea, its nobles and sages have perished in hunger. There are no Jews left in Jaén, Mallorca, Malaga, and Almeria. All traces of life are gone, and those who survived were beaten down. For this I wail in my grief and mourn, for they have melted away like water. For, this is a hard one, for Sillé Massá, I groan in distress. City of sages, whose light barred darkness, its pillar of Talmud was toppled and broken. Its Mishnah was trampled, cursed, and crushed. The upright were slaughtered, and no one was spared. Fez was razed, and its brethren butchered. Telmes in splendor shines no more. For Meknes and Quetta, my cry is bitter. For Dera, I put on sackcloth and mourn. Their blood on the Sabbath was spilled like water. What could I hope for or possibly say when this is the work of my own hand? From God this calamity has come upon me, and now within me my heart's aflame for my soul which has strayed from longed-for lands and silently grieves in her trouble and shame. She hopes for mercy from her rock and strength, for refuge beneath his wing's shadow. Whenever she thinks of his name, she revives, though she'll face the hail of her handmaiden's arrows, till the Lord with compassion looks down from the skies. So you see, in the very end, there's a little bit of a bitter note. It is my own fault this happened, referring to the concept in Jewish theology of mipnei chataenu, because of our many sins, this has happened to us, we've been in exile, we've been forced to suffer these things. So that's on the darker side of his poetry. Quite often, though, his poems are tempered with a bit of black humor. So here, let's hear some shorter poems that give you a sense of his worldview. Now, let us recall, by the way, I should tell you that when he was exiled, he became tremendously impecunious because he made his living, like so many of these Andalusian poets, he made his living with his Arabic pen by writing poems for hire. Tribute poems, marriage poems, epitaphs, you know, all kinds of things like this. And when he was exiled from Iberian Peninsula, he didn't have any more customer base. So what could he do? He was broke. And so he has a few poems that really speak to his penury. This is one of my favorites. The heavenly spheres and fortune stars veered off course the day I was born. If I were a seller of candles, the sun would never go down. I struggle to manage and even succeed, but I'm thwarted by the stars in the sky. If I were a dealer in shrouds, no one, as long as I lived, would die. If I had a scheme to profit from arms and going to war, all the foes in the world would be friends and fight no more. Right? Meaning that everything goes wrong in his life. If he made candles, the sun would stop setting. If he made funeral shrouds, people would stop dying. If he sold guns, people would stop fighting. Like, he just can't win. That's kind of an Ibn Ezra-esque sort of sentiment. It's also especially noteworthy, let's recall this when we talk about his astrology, so much of this has to do, the stars veered off course, you know, things were set in stone by the celestial heavens and so on. Here's another one that describes his experience trying to put together a few rubles from his poetry. I get up and head to the patron's house, right? Because wealthy people would pay for these poems. I get up and head to the patron's house. I arrive and they tell me he's gone. And then they tell me he's sleeping in the evening when I return. Either he's on his horse or else he already turned in. Pity the poor creature born under the sign of misfortune. Right? Once again, referring to himself, my fortune, my stars has put me in this case. Here's one last one. I'm sorry, I really enjoy these poems. Well, there's two more here. I won't read both, there's too many. One of them here, he talks about how his cloak is so full of holes that if a fly were to land on it with its full weight, it would collapse and all kinds of things like that. But here's one talking about his flies as well. Who can I turn to in my distress? The flies have plundered my home. They will not leave me a minute of peace, attacking me fiercely like foes. Across my eyelids and eyes they race. In my ears they recite their poems. Like a pack of hungry wolves, they devour my bread when I'm eating alone. And as though I'd asked them over like friends, they take what they want on their own. It seems they're only seeking their share when I offer them lamb and wine. But that, it turns out, isn't enough. They also covet what's mine. If I summon guests to come and dine, at the head of the table they swarm, and so I long for winter, lest I starve because of them. It's cold and rain will wipe them out. Thank God who dwells with the Kruvim. Meaning he's so pleased that in the winter eventually be done with these lice and other flies that torment him. Anyways, you get a sense from these selection of poems, he's like extremely harried, he has no money, he's going from place to place hoping for wealthy patrons who will pay him for his Arabic-style poetry, and he's just having trouble putting it together. And in fact, he was a person of tremendous brilliance, but he simply could not communicate the old way of life, meaning before he turned 50, into this new cultural environment, and he was forced to turn his attention to something else. And this attention to something else is, as I mentioned earlier, really what was his, the kernel of his success. I do not want to
avoid the very obvious fact that he's a deeply religious individual. I mean, you have this sense of humor, you have this dark side. He wrote a few romantic poems, just like Yehuda Levi and Shmuel HaNagid, perhaps maybe not as R-rated as Shmuel HaNagid's, but nevertheless, romantic poems. But he also wrote quite a few beautiful religious poems. I'll just read you one of them. Oh my gosh, I read way too much poetry for this class. I mean, I wish Americans would read more poetry in general, but here we go. This one's called To the Soul. Sent down from a luminous fountain of life, drawn from a sacred place and pure, created as one though not with form, and greater by far than honor or wisdom. Why were you ushered into the world and then in the dark of the body imprisoned? At first, its sleep seems sweet to you, but in the end, it's hard and bitter. Put the pleasures of time behind you. Unless it's exile, you'd always wander. Consider your glory, for this is your good, to serve the living God in awe. Listen while living within this world and be bound to the one to come with the Lord. Right? Very deep philosophical, religious musings about the plight of the soul coming into this body and so on. Now, we are going to leave his poetry altogether for the remainder of this class, but I have to take you to just two very difficult poems, one by him and one by his son. As I mentioned earlier, his son went, as they say, off the derech very significantly and eventually became a Muslim. The last story that we have of Yitzchak is that he refused to accompany Yehud HaLevi, his father-in-law, to Israel. They had made it all the way across to Egypt, and they had a falling out there. He says, I'm not going back to my wife in Spain, not going back to my son. I myself am a poet just like you, Shver. He probably didn't say Shver because that's a Yiddish word. He probably said father-in-law, whatever that is in Spanish. Abuelo, I don't know. He probably said, you know, suelo? Suegro, sounds like Schwer, very good. So suegro, I'm gonna make it here big time in Alexandria with my Arabic poetry. It turned out he didn't do so well. He had to wander around as well. He was in Baghdad for a while, Syria, and ultimately he became a Muslim. There are some questions about exactly how that happened, when that happened, and one of these poems here is attributed by some specialists to Ibn Ezra writing about the conversion of his son to Islam as if his son died. Other scholars say, no, he's not writing about it in this metaphorical sense. He's actually writing about his son after his son died. Apparently his son predeceased Ibn Ezra. And still other scholars say, no, this is a poem for hire. As we've seen before, it's just a poem that he wrote for someone who lost a son. But unlike some of the poetry we've seen before with Yehuda Levi, it does not have the same immediacy, but it definitely has more, to my mind, than someone who wrote about someone else's son. Anyways, come, Father, approach and mourn, for the Lord your God has distanced from you your son, your one and only child, Isaac, whom you always loved. You hear the shibbutz there, right? The reference to the phrase, you know, the son you love, even Isaac. Quote, I am the man who has witnessed affliction and watched as joy was driven away. The fruit of my loins has been taken from me, words I'd never imagined I'd say. I'd always envisioned him offering comfort and being near me as I aged, but all my labor has been in vain, for I've given birth to my own dismay, and how can I rejoice again when Isaac has breathed his last and died? Moment by bitter moment, I weep and send up a mournful cry and lament, thinking of how 3 years ago he died alone in a foreign land, after he'd wandered from place to place. And so my soul for his spirit moaned until I'd be able to bring him home. All night and day alone I grieved, what pain and suffering I knew then. And this is the story of Isaac, my son. Be kind to me now. Bear with me, friends. The comfort you offer adds to my grief. So do not speak of my heart's desire or even utter his name to me. Time has quenched my final ember. How could it do any worse to me, having decreed my ruin forever and taken from me the light of my life? Now my flesh and heart are failing, at Isaac's heart gave way when he died.
Lord, in whose hands all is held, whose will extends through all creatures, speak to the heart of this grieving father who held your name in awe as a child. Waken the spirit of consolation and let it pass through a heart now broken. He taught with his wife his son to fear you, so would he follow on the path they do. While he was a boy, you set it before him for the sake of your servant, Isaac, their son. Very powerful poem. We also have in the corpus of poetry from Andalusia several of Isaac's poems, The Son, including this one. And this is the final poem for the evening. I apologize for so many. I just get overwhelmed with how great they are. This is the last one. This is a poem by Yitzhak ibn Ezra, his son, entitled Conversion, which many scholars say represent his late in life regret over his conversion. So in other words, he became a Muslim and then became un-Muslimed. Here we go. They contend against me for having abandoned the Lord's covenant for godless injustice. But Amram's son in anger destroyed the law's tablets in his disgust, meaning Moses broke the tablets. And the lion, Yehuda, went to Tamar, and Amnon to his sister, a virgin. And David was tried by the Lord and erred beside Bathsheba, like Delilah's Samson. He's referring to all these characters in the Bible who committed very grave, I don't know what the right word is. They definitely transgressed in a very big way, and trying to figure out what that means. And some of the transgressions are hard to understand, and there's a lot of rabbinic commentary, but on the surface level, he's saying, why me? You know, everyone else has done these things. I never tasted impure food. I always thought it a rotting carcass. And if I tell you the prophet's mad, meaning Muhammad, but acknowledge him with every blessing, my mouth speaks, but my heart replies, you're lying again and bearing false witness. I've sought the shadow of the presence's wing and ask of you now, my Lord, forgiveness. Okay. Also really fantastic, fascinating stuff. I wish we had more time to explore. But let us go back to where we are with Ibn Ezra. He referred to himself as always Avraham HaSfaradi, like Moses Maimonides referred to himself as Hasfaradi. And this is perhaps, in many ways, the beginnings of the very well-established, cemented Sephardi ideology. We should bear in mind that unlike almost every other Jewish sub-ethnic group, it's only the Sephardim who really retained their specific identity as an ethnic group for so long in Jewish history. I mean, you know, I'm a Litvak, and a Lithuanian Jew, but I don't know if my grandchildren or great-grandchildren will really think of themselves as Litvaks. They may think of themselves as, I don't know, Canucks, because, you know, we have a few generations in Canada. But will they really think of themselves as Litvaks? I don't know. But Sephardim really stick close to this idea, and you can see it early on that he refers to him always as Hasfaradi, the Sephardic one, the Spaniard, because he spent, of course, most of his life in Europe. Okay, let's look at his biblical commentary, which is absolutely fascinating, astounding, and completely surprising. As you shall see here, he is one of the most important of the classical biblical commentaries. This is a copy or a page from a book called the Mikraot Gedolot, the Great Scriptures, which is kind of like the standard, traditional, I won't say exactly critical edition, but the primary reference edition of the Bible that you'll find in scholarly Jewish homes. And there's a number of commentators that are always represented in Mikraot Gedolot, regardless of whoever publishes it. You will always have Rashi there. You always have Ramban, Nachmanides. There are a few that will definitely be there. And then depending on the printing, you may have a few others that are included or not included. Ibn Ezra is one of the commentaries that is always included. You can see here he is. Ibn Ezra is central to the traditional interpretation of the Bible, and he's included with the greatest of the greats in terms of their commentaries. This is extremely surprising in many ways because he differs so dramatically with his peers. Sometimes, with tremendous disrespect, apparently, referring to his contemporaries as fools, as blockheads, as ignoramuses, speaking of them in very contemptuous terms and dismissing their arguments in a manner that you know really wouldn't be tolerated in the yeshivas today, in my humble opinion. And moreover, more significantly, he says a lot of really controversial things, so much so that in many yeshivas, even though he has pride of place in Mikra Gedolot, the systematic study of Ibn Ezra is discouraged, because when you study Ibn Ezra, you will come up against some very difficult hashkafic philosophical problems. Nevertheless, because of those philosophical problems, he actually inspired the composition of more than 36 super commentaries. Meaning, he's writing a commentary on the Bible, and more than 36 other rabbis have written commentaries on his commentary, trying to parse out why did he say this, and how do we solve this problem that he brought up, and so on. Very, very, perhaps more than any other of the traditional commentaries, including Rashi, including Ramban, Ibn Ezra is the one that inspired the most super commentary activity. That's just an indicative of his provocative nature. Here is perhaps why he got such a big start in the modern era. This is Baruch Spinoza, one of the most challenging figures of the early modern age. He was a Jew who advanced a series of theological notions. He's actually a Sephardi as well, living in the Netherlands at the time, who challenged a lot of core theological notions. In his theological political tractatus, he praised Ibn Ezra and said of him, "Ibn Ezra, a man of enlightened intelligence and no small learning, was the first, so far as I know, to treat of this opinion." Now, what is this opinion that Spinoza is talking about and attributing it to Ibn Ezra? It's essentially the idea that there was human involvement in the composition of the Torah, that the Torah was influenced by historical factors. People other than Moses wrote Torah, and this is like an earth-shattering idea that eventually would mature into the Wellhausian school of biblical criticism and so on. I will look at one example of where he gets this. Many hold that Spinoza was way off base in terms of how he assessed Ibn Ezra, but I will leave it to you to judge that. Here is another figure who's perhaps not so much on the kosher v'yosher list of Orthodox Jewry, Abraham Geiger, widely considered the founder of the Reform movement. This is the beginning of the 19th century. It was more of a grassroots movement than a movement with a single leader who kind of directed which way it went. But nevertheless, Geiger wrote of Ibn Ezra, "Is it then any wonder that everywhere one readily takes him as a member of his own sect?" Which is true. If you go into an Orthodox synagogue and you say Ibn Ezra, people say, "Oh, Ibn Ezra, fascinating." You know, you can cite an Ibn Ezra in the greatest yeshivas of Yerushalayim, of Lakewood, even here in Brooklyn, you can cite Ibn Ezra. And you can also go to Reform temples and you can talk about Ibn Ezra as if he was some kind of proto-Geiger figure several hundred years before the Reform movement was born. How is it possible that one person can be the genesis of such a diverse world of opinion? We have to agree with Geiger that he's surprised, like I am, that so many people claim Ibn Ezra as their intellectual ancestor. So let's look at one passage, this mysterious passage on Deuteronomy 34:1. This Deuteronomy 34:1, if you're familiar with the numbers there, you realize we're at the very end of the Torah. And this describes Moses, you know, gives a last admonition to the Jewish people. He has a flight of poetry. And then there's a description of how he goes up to the Mount Nebo and he looks out over the Holy Land, and then he dies and he is buried there. So Ibn Ezra just says flat out, what happened to the last 12 verses of the Torah, which describe after Moses' death? And Ibn Ezra says simply, straight out, Joshua wrote them, not Moses. Someone else wrote them. Of course, all the other commentators and the super commentators go to town on Ibn Ezra, saying, no, it can't be like that. Didn't you read Rashi? Rashi was before Ibn Ezra. Rashi writes, and he's quoting the Gemara, it's not a secret. Is it possible that Moshe died and he wrote and Moshe died? If he's dead, how could he write that Moshe died? Rather, up to this point, Moshe wrote, and afterward, Joshua wrote. Rabbi Meir said another opinion, like in other words, this is essentially Ibn Ezra's opinion. Then Rabbi Meir says, Rabbi Meir is a Talmudic rabbi, is it possible that the Torah should be missing anything? Meaning we call it Torah's Moshe, right? The Torah of Moshe, and we believe that it is whole and complete and authoritative. So really what it means is, according to Rabbi Meir, rather the Blessed One spoke, telling Moshe what to write down, and Moshe wrote with tears. Meaning Moshe did in fact, he did write what was dictated to him, and Moses died there and was buried and so on. No one knows where his grave is and so on. So we do have a traditional approach, but if you look at his passage on Deuteronomy 34:1, that's not the only passage he refers to. He says in that passage, if you know the secret of the 12, and he's referring to the last 12 verses of the Torah, and then he lists about five or six other places in the Torah where the text itself seems to imply a chronological gap, meaning there's a reference in the text that it doesn't seem it could have been written logically at the time that it said it would be written. In other words, and you can look at it yourself and you can puzzle over it with you. I don't want to take too much time with it. But he's pointing, according to Spinoza, he's pointing to the idea that the Torah was possibly written by other people at other times and put together. That seems like a big stretch for reading Ibn Ezra. But the very idea that the Torah may have had some kind of, you know, multiple stages in history, which is an anathema kind of concept to traditional Judaism, is nevertheless where a lot of the non-Orthodox movements look to Ibn Ezra as their intellectual parent. There is, of course, 36 plus commentaries that will tell you it's not so in Ibn Ezra, but the fact that you need 36 plus commentaries says something about the degree of controversy that he inspired. And this is where Ibn Ezra really comes into his own. By the way, his biblical commentaries, he would not even have written them had he not been forced into exile. Because what happened is when he was living in the Iberian Peninsula, he was making his living with Arabic poetry. When he got into Christian lands and he hung out in the Jewish communities there, nobody was interested in those things. But he was an educated guy. He had literary skills. They wanted something, so he started writing Hebrew manuscripts, including his biblical commentary. Because he was so poor, he often sold those copies that he wrote, including the original copies that he kept for himself. And so we actually have multiple versions of many of these books, which he was forced to rewrite from memory over time. But included in this period of his life, when he's writing biblical commentary, he's also taking his scientific knowledge that he acquired in Andalus and is now transmitting it into a Jewish environment in Hebrew, and making it possible for Jews to study the far more advanced civilization that the Arabs had. Their science could not be compared at all to the Christian science of the day. And so Ibn Ezra was this kind of cultural transmitter. One of the most popular things he wrote, and it was like kind of a hot topic for much of the literature of a couple of hundred years before and after, was a manual on how to use an astrolabe. Here's a medieval Muslim astrolabe shown here. It's essentially a device that measures the inclination of the various stars and planets and the sun. It can be used in navigation. It can be used in measurement of vast distances. It's essentially a pocket calculator when nothing like this had existed before. But as you can see, it's not a very simple looking instrument to use. So there were many manuals written on how to use astrolabes. Also, they had to be, because they deal with constellations, they had to be personalized for particular areas. If you had an astrolabe that was made for Baghdad, it would not be very useful in London, because all of the various celestial positions changed when you moved that far west or east in latitude. So these manuals for astrolabes were written in many languages at the time. Even Chaucer wrote a manual on how to use an astrolabe. He didn't actually finish it, but there's one passage that's quoted in the source that I referred to earlier that says, these true conclusions in English, meaning he's writing a manual in English for the astrolabe, as well as sufficeth to these noble Greeks, these same conclusions in Greek, and to Arabians in Arabic, and to Jews in Hebrew, and to the Latin folk in Latin. Obviously, this was written before spell check. Or maybe we say after spell check, you know, like when you're typing on your iPhone. That would be a funny line. Chaucer wrote this whole passage on his iPhone. At any rate, what's very interesting about this particular passage, which is why it's so widely cited, is because you can see in this, in microcosm, the transmission of scientific knowledge. First starts out with the Greeks, because, you know, the ancient Greeks, Periclean period was absolutely over the top in terms of their mathematical and scientific advancement, and much of that information was then absorbed into the Roman world and the Arabic world. The Christian world lost it altogether. That's the Dark Ages. And from the Arabic world, it was the Jews in Hebrew, like Ibn Ezra, who then brought that knowledge out of Al-Andalus into European countries in Latin. And so Ibn Ezra also wrote in Latin, perhaps working with a team translating his ideas, but he wrote in Latin and he became extremely famous. Not quite as famous, perhaps, as this Jew. It's not a very good kind of pixelated. Petrus Alphonsus, who was also a Jew from Spanish derivation, who went to France and converted to Christianity and essentially sold his knowledge. He was a great Jewish scholar who was letting the Christians know what kind of scientific advances they had in Arabic culture. By comparison to Ibn Ezra, however, Petrus Alphonsus, also known as Petrus Judaeus, was a complete ignoramus. And he had like basically a high school education, whereas Ibn Ezra was a tenured professor. And so Petrus Alphonsus was kind of making things up as he went along, lots of errors, very superficial and so on. But because the Arabic science was so advanced, he was the principal conduit for many to the beginnings of Arabic wisdom. But Ibn Ezra's wisdom was far more sophisticated, far more accurate, and so his scholarship really prevailed over people like Petrus Alphonsus. It is interesting, however, that the trope of the Jew who abandons Judaism in order to become an agent of cultural change or cultural transmission in a foreign culture is one that goes way back to the ancient period and continues even to the present day. If you go to the local bookstores, and by the way, for those of you who were born after 1990, a bookstore is kind of like a store where you can actually walk in and buy paper books. You can find lots of these popular books about Orthodox Jews who leave the fold and then explain Orthodoxy to the secular world, usually with a kind of a negative bent associated with it. It's a long, long story in Jewish history, and maybe one day we should kind of catalog these individuals and see what's psychologically similar about them. At any rate, let's focus in on one of his most famous scientific books, and you have to place this within the context of 12th century science. This is a period, of course, when people believe very deeply in astrology, the power of the stars to determine a person's fate. And we saw it in his Andalusian period in many of his poems, talking about how the stars determined his fate, that he should be poor, and so on. So he wrote many books, actually most of them within the space of one extremely productive year. He wrote many books on astronomy and astrology, one after another, and he made a huge amount of money with them. He actually sold them several times over, principally in France. Then one of those books we'll look at right now, because it's most fascinating, I think, is called the Sefer Hamoladot, which literally means the book of things that will be born, or nativities. And because the astrolabe can be used with astronomical tables to determine things that will happen in the future, we have here the genesis of a scientific calculation of what could happen to a person's life, and in fact, the entire world, over a period of time. Because you can figure out, well, Venus will be in this place, and the moon will be over here, and you'll predict an eclipse and all kinds of things. So he wrote a book on how to figure out what is going to happen in the future astronomically, and then what that means astrologically. And this is the foundation, essentially, of horoscopes, right? But it's tremendously more sophisticated than what you read in the newspaper. So in this section here, he writes about, yeah, this is true. This is the way it works, that everyone's life is determined by the stars. There is actually a huge discussion in the Talmud about it, a question of whether or not Ein Mazal Yisrael. Is there, we say in Hebrew, we say Mazal Tov, right? Which means literally good constellation, meaning the stars are aligned. If someone gets married, you say Mazal Tov, meaning, may this be an auspicious moment of the constellations for your marriage. Mazal Tov doesn't mean congratulations or good luck. It means auspicious astrological moment. As we would say in Canada, we would end that with A, auspicious astrological moment, A. So the Talmud has this whole debate. Ein mazal the Israel or yesh mazal the Israel? Does this apply to the Jewish people, that they're bound by the stars like this? The Gemara concludes yes, but there are some exceptions. So in Ibn Ezra's Sefer HaMoledot, he goes through 8 exceptions to the rule. How it is that you can overcome your destiny. Okay, so I thought we should look at some of those. Okay, let's look at some of those. So the first one is, he says, you got to understand that the stars give a destiny both to entire nations and to individuals. So it's possible that you may be born under an unfortunate constellation, but you will be swept along by the general positivity of your national horoscope. Meaning, and he uses the sense of nation, by the way, really more synonymous with religion or ethnicity than with what we would call nation. But he says, like, the Jewish people are destined to survive. Netzach Yisrael lo yishaker, right? The eternity of Israel is not a lie. But individual Jews, chas v'shalom, may have a different horoscope because the stars predict an entire people as well as individuals. So even though these are kind of like reasons why you shouldn't feel bad if you don't get the horoscope it says in the newspaper, because, you know, there's all these exceptional rules. But if you were really an expert, you would be able to figure them out. So the astrology refers to entire peoples as well as individuals, and sometimes they come into conflict and you don't know which one is going to win. Borders and climates. This is another aspect which I didn't want us to take too much time on, but he was also very, very particular about vocabulary, and he was unusual in that he refused to adopt Arabic words to express Hebrew philosophical concepts, which made him sometimes very difficult to understand. You know, people like Petrus Alphonsus would just borrow terms from Arabic and then would use them in Latin, and then people would say, okay, that's the word for it. Like, the word for one of the most important Arabic mathematicians is al-jibr, and so that becomes algebra, right? So many of these words just sort of transfer. Another one is the Arabic word klim, which refers to kind of like a region or a zone, which becomes aklim in Hebrew. Or, I'm sorry, in I think klim was, I forget whether it was Hindu, it was perhaps, and that becomes aklim in Arabic, and then it becomes climate in English. But he refused to use that term. He used the term gvul, boundary, in Hebrew. And so he was really quite, what's the right word for it? Not ethnocentric, a stickler, but I'm trying to say something like, it's like he was like national pride about this. Says the Hebrew language says everything. We don't need to borrow nothing from nobody. We take only Hebrew words. Like the famous word in Hebrew, you know what they call the rear axle of a car in Hebrew is rear axle, right? You know how you say the front axle? Rear axle hakadmoni, right? The rear axle that's in the front, right? So, yeah, the French are like that. They have an academy where they're very particular. They don't accept words into French. They try not to borrow words from other languages, and they invent their own that are French origin. And in Hebrew too, especially in the 1950s, they had an institute that tried to keep Hebrew pure. Instead of using a word like economia, right, economy, they'll use the word kalkala, which is, you know, totally different origin. Anyways, off track. Borders and climates, how can this affect it? Well, as I mentioned, the astrolabe is like specifically associated with particular areas. So if you're living in one area and the stars are aligned for your horoscope in that particular area, what happens if you move to a significantly new place? Well, the stars are aligned differently for you over there. And in fact, anyone get the reference to this week's parsha? I think you did, right? Mishana makom, mishana mazal. Literally, you change your place, you change your mazal. And in this week's parsha, Avram is forced to go to a different land because the Gemara says, hey, where you live right now, you'll never have kids. You must go to Eretz Yisrael because over there, you'll have a different mazal, a different constellation that will apply to you. It's really cool stuff. Another thing that can change, the world year. There's a whole cycle of years. It's not 364 and a quarter odd days. There's a whole cycle of years where the general position of the Earth with regards to other planets can change on like a 500-year horizon of change. And so even though you may have positive horoscopes individually, nationally, in terms of climates, it could be that the entire globe is in that particular period of world year that could change everything as well. And your socioeconomic background, this is fascinating stuff. You may have a mazal that says you're going to be a king, that you are going to be melech, that you have all of the qualities of a king. But let's say you're born into a slave household. Well, you'll become a big businessman instead. You'll end up, you know, owning your own company. I'm just thinking of things I shouldn't say because it's going to offend somebody politically. But you'll end up, you know, you'll go from, it's true, like if you were a slave and you had the mazal to be a king, you're not going to be a king. It's too far a leap, but you could go from being a slave to being a huge business owner. In other words, the general trajectory of your mazal will point in a certain direction, and the realities of where you live socioeconomically will dictate the starting point of that change. Also, forces of nature that, you know, you may have the mazal, you know, a person may have a mazal to live a long and healthy life, but if you decide that you want to be a skydiver and you want to, you know, try sky hang gliding and all kinds of risky sports and you want to challenge the law of gravity, all bets are off. You know, he uses the example of you want to go out to sea. You know, you may have this great mazal, but if you put yourself into a position of danger, it could be that the forces of nature have a stronger mazal than you do. And so they can be overpowered. Sorry, question. Don't push your luck, right? Exactly, which is a translation of "Ein mashkichin al hanisim," right? We don't wait for miracles, which is a beautiful thing. In Muncie, New York, I lived there many years ago, and you know, they have very few street lights in a lot of suburban streets, and it's a good thing the Hasidim there, they dress in very bright, vibrant colors, you know, so. At night, it can be quite dangerous, right? Because people are driving and the Hasidim are all in black, right? So a local Judaica store, he's still there, I think. Tuvia's. He sold these fluorescent bands that had, it said on the Ein Mashkichin Al Hanes, we do not rely on miracles, right? It's a very beautiful thing. Anyways, so the forces of nature could overwhelm a person's mazal as well. And here's the last one. This is perhaps the most important one for us. The wise soul, because he says that we do have this concept that I referred to earlier of Ein Mazal Yisrael, that there is no sign for the Jewish people, meaning the mazalot, the stars do not have power over the Jewish people. He says when a Jew is occupied with Torah or mitzvos, with chesed, with kindness, then they remove themselves from the gravitational pull of the stars. Now, when they are engaged in the study of Torah, that's possible to remove them altogether from the entire gravitational pull, and the mazalot during that time do not affect them, which gives rise perhaps to the concept that we have in the Talmud of shluchei mitzvot ena nizakin, right? A person who's involved in doing a mitzvah is not harmed at that time, nor on the way back, and so on. There's a lot more to say than we can in this brief period. But at any rate, here is a quick selection of Ibn Ezra's thought. You see both the influence of astrology and also the influence of Jewish philosophy and Jewish texts very much involved in determining how astrology works. It's a book that's definitely really worth studying. I want to spend some more time with it. Anyways, let us go now to his legacy. And one of the more amazing things about Ibn Ezra is that he is the only medieval rabbi after whom a crater on the moon is named. There is actually a crater on the moon named Ibn Ezra. And the reason for it is because it looks a little bit like a matzah ball, as you can see. I thought that was funnier than it actually was. But his contribution to science, even though, you know, we Jews tend to think of Ibn Ezra, we think of his commentary on the Chumash, the short commentary, the long commentary, we think of these things. But in the larger world, his introduction of Andalusian Arabic science to the Christian world was incredibly important. His description of how to use the astrolabe, his description of the way that you chart the stars was so significant that modern science is deeply indebted to his contributions. And so much so that when, you know, they mapped out the craters on the moon, he was a leading candidate for whom should be expressed gratitude. It is ironic that we know of him only in one smaller, maybe, aspect of his activity. It's closest to home, but nevertheless, he was a figure that strode tall on the world scene. I have omitted many other aspects of his work. He influenced the poetry. Even there's a John Lennon song that is taken from some of his early poetry, because he influenced a tremendous amount of Christian thought far beyond the much more narrow audience of Jews in Christian Europe that he appealed to. So with that, I'd like to conclude. I hope you found the life of Ibn Ezra as fascinating as I do. We will return, as I mentioned, next week with a very special program. I hope you're all going to come because it's going to be really great. A chance to celebrate. My family will be here, God willing, to celebrate with us. And I hope you have an excellent
week.
And
it occurred to me, I haven't really told you what is this book about. So here is the book. This is the very last plug for the book that I will put into these lecture series. Basically, the Piasechina Rebbe, a very holy individual. Here's this iconic photograph of him that you see all over the place, a very holy-looking individual. Was a major Hasidic thinker of the 20th century. Had already published a very important book called Chovas HaTalmidim, The Obligation of Students, that was extremely popular in the 1930s. And he had this grand plan for reinvigorating world Jewry with more enthusiasm for their Jewish background. Unfortunately, it was interrupted by the Holocaust, and he found himself in the Warsaw Ghetto and ministering to his followers for the duration of the war. Even though he received many offers, even from the American Jewish Congress, the Joint Distribution Committee, and the Underground Resistance, he was offered many times to be taken out of the ghetto. He insisted on remaining with his followers throughout and ministering them in a pastoral sense throughout the war. Luckily for our purposes, he recorded his weekly sermons. And when he realized that the ghetto was going to be destroyed, and he along with it, he gave them to the secret Oneg Shabbat Society, which was documenting the Jewish life in the ghetto. And they were buried in this tin milk container that I put on the cover of the book. They were discovered in 1950 by a Polish construction worker. And they were published under the title Esh Kodesh, or Holy Fire. A fascinating story overall. Now, the small contribution that I've made to the research on Esh Kodesh is, you know, the way he describes his sermons, there's no reference whatsoever to Nazis or Germans. I mean, there's a lot of discussion of death and destruction and persecution and suffering, but if you didn't know the specific context, you might think this is just a really depressing 19th century Hasidic work. It's only from the context that we know he's talking about the Holocaust. However, since we know the dates when he delivered each of those sermons, what I did is I went back to the various journals and memoirs and newspapers and German documentation, and I found out what was happening in the ghetto that very week, street by street, on a micro-historical level, and then I compared it to what the Rebbe said on Shabbat, and I saw that in many, many cases, he was speaking directly to the concerns of his congregation. In other words, he was using his pulpit as a way to offer consolation and guidance and theological direction to assist specifically with the processing of the horrible events of the past week. And it's absolutely fascinating. It's a sustained work of spiritual heroism. And I believe that reading his drashot, his sermons, within the context of their historical setting is really the best way to appreciate the book, to appreciate his words. Because then you really see, to use a Yiddish, a Hebrew term, godless, his greatness. I am very pleased that one of the premier students of Pious Session Chassidus is Rabbi Moshe Weinberger, who has a synagogue by the same name, Congregation H. Kodesh, and in his letter called the Haskama, or a sort of an approbation letter, he writes that basically he has had this book, the H. Kodesh, the original Hebrew, on his desk for 40 years, and so much of it was opaque to him until he read my book, which made me feel really great, and I'm telling as many people as I can. Anyways, we have the book launch on Monday night, the 30th. I really hope if you're in Brooklyn, you're able to join us and to celebrate the life and the work and the contribution to world culture through Hasidic thought that is representative of the Pious Sechner Rebbe. If you can't make it to Brooklyn, I would be very honored if you wanted to get a copy of the book. They're available, of course, on all the internet outlets, and you can certainly ask it at your local Jewish bookstore, which is even better because then you support a local business. And I guess that's about it for the plug. I'm very proud of the work. I think it represents something useful for people, and I hope you'll like it too.